Southland. I'm so glad that you're here to worship with us. And all of you online, we're glad that you're with us as well, and glad that you're here to worship with us, even if you're not here in person. Would you stand with us together? Let's sing this song together, please.
No. I'm thinking as we sang, stand up for Jesus. What a great Salvation Army hymn. But it didn't sound right till the trumpets started, right? And then we recognize that the battle in our life is real. We face challenges and enemies on every side, and yet God is faithful to fight with us, to fight for us, and we're here today to celebrate that. We come today to celebrate His presence and the life that we have in Him. I think we always have been promising you that we'll keep you informed of the things that go on in terms of the ministries of our church, which we do, the giving of our church, which you are always gracious and generous with your giving. You know, we've been talking to you about this dream of paying off the mortgage by June, the first Sunday in June of this year. Listen, the giving in last year was tremendous for the mortgage, but just in December and through January, we were able to make a payment of $107,000 toward that. Yeah. Now, what I always celebrate is even though we have this loan with the Wesleyan Investment Foundation, so every dime that we pay in interest is just going to build more churches, which is wonderful, we still like not having to pay interest. Are you with me on that? Maybe you enjoy paying interest. It's not a thing for me. But listen, just because of your generous giving above and beyond, we've been able to save $1,684,691 in interest. Because that's how far ahead we are. We're well over 140 payments we don't have to pay. And that's because you give so generously. So keep that up. Keep giving above and beyond your regular giving to our general fund, your faith promise to missions. Just keep being generous to the work of this church. It'd be so exciting to see that 1.7 something million paid off in just a few months. So we're praying to that end. We are sad here at Southland. At the same time, we've lost a great friend to all of us, Jinx Jenkins, in this past week. And I know you all have been so good to pray for Debbie and their family. And we have a celebration of his life tomorrow night here. Callings 2 to 7, and then 7 o'clock's the service. If you can't be here in person, though, we are going to live stream it at 7 o'clock, and yet only on the website. So it won't be on social media, but you can click watch live at 7 o'clock tomorrow if you can't be here and be a part of celebrating Jinx's life. It seems like he should be standing right here, doesn't it? And leading us in worship. And yet, because we have hope in Jesus, we do not need to fear death and the grave. And that's why we can celebrate his life. And so we want to go to the Lord today and bring all that we are to him and worship him and trust him. Let's pray together. Oh, Lord Jesus, we are so grateful for this day to know that we can stand for you because you fight our battles before us and with us and for us. And so we bow today grateful that you have fought and won the battle for our eternal life. Thank you for taking all of our guilt and sin upon yourself on the cross and rising from the dead so we too can have this hope because of your great grace, because of your forgiveness. Today, there are people hurting in this room and with us online who've themselves experienced grief or disappointment or a broken relationship, some kind of struggle, bad news has come, and yet you have called us to bring all of that to you, cast it upon you. So we do that today. And we pray that you would provide strength and help and hope to the hearts of everyone who's part of this worship experience here and around the world. But Lord, in the same way, we thank you for the hope that we have in Jesus when we face those burdens, those struggles. We are confident through your word and your spirit today, you will lift us up to who you are and you will empower us to follow you. We ask for that blessing in this moment. In the wonderful name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Would you sing that with us, please?
This reason you are great, O Lord God. There is none like you, and there is no God but you, by all that we have heard with our ears.
Southland first began, the staff decided that they needed to form an emergency response team. With this team, it was the responsibility to help Southland if there's a need, specifically a medical responsibility, because most incidents in a church are health related. So about a year ago, the elders decided that we needed to be more formal and decided that we needed to have a leadership team. That leadership team decided to focus on three responsibilities: facilities, medical, and safety. So with the facilities team, that's not a repairs and maintenance team. What that team responsibility is to move Southland in and out of the building under circumstances. So if there's a fire in the building, we get Southland out. If there's weather condition, we get Southland to the interior of the building. The medical team, again, was formed and is still functioning because incidents that happen in the church, most of them are medical related. Today, some of our medical team aren't here because they're sick. So where I'm heading with this is we need help. The third team that's composed as part of the emergency response team is safety. You know, we want to protect and look out for the safety of Southland. The people that are assisting in this capacity, some of them are willing to engage in a conflict, but 65% of the members of this safety team, they don't want to have anything to do with conflict. And that's all right, because we need both people. We support one another, and we work well together. So what we're asking you to do is join our team. Right now, we have approximately 24 members of Southland who are on our emergency response team, but more. Most of our team, we're on call, both services, every Sunday. So we'd like to take a break once in a while. But if the Holy Spirit is speaking to you that this might be something that you're interested in, don't let doubt hold you back. We believe and trust in the Holy Spirit. We pray before every Sunday morning. Law enforcement officers are part of our group. They join us in prayer. We're a good group. It's a ministry. We joke around a lot, but we pray a lot. We have fellowship together. We have monthly meetings. We're focused on the Holy Spirit. We're focused on Southland. So if you're interested, if you think this might be something you can help us with, please join us. We have informational packets at the hub. You can see any of the people. Ask questions, but this is a group of men and women that are devoted to Flint BC. Thank you.
Let's sing this last song together.
My Jesus, my
Lord. Yeah. Praise his name. Thanks for standing. You can be seated.
Letters. Three words. One sentence. And I hope you never forget it. I hope you always remember these 13 letters, these three words, and this one complete sentence. Jesus is better. He's better than any passing dream you might be chasing after. He's better than any worldly ambition that may have captured your devotion. He's better than anything that could distract you from doing what you were created to do. He's better than money, cars, clothes, entertainment, achievement, and popularity. He's better than anything this world can offer you. Jesus is better. He's better than any person that has ever walked this earth. He's wiser than Gandhi and smarter than Einstein. He's more eloquent than Shakespeare and more creative than Mozart. He's more powerful than Napoleon and more compassionate than Mother Teresa. There's never been anyone like him, nor will there ever be. Not even close. Jesus is better. The Bible says he's better than Adam, better than Abraham, better than Moses, David, and Mary. He's better than the angels, better than the demons, better than any prophet, priest, or saint. From beginning to end, this book has one beautiful story and one unified theme. The Bible is clear. Jesus is better. But there will be times when it's hard to believe. Times when it doesn't feel like Jesus is better. The world will reject you. Your flesh will fight you, and the devil will lie to you. Storms will come. You're gonna face disappointment, deception, betrayal, and rejection. You're gonna feel tired, empty, brokenhearted, scared, and alone. But don't forget in the darkness what you learned in the light. Jesus is better. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the Prince of Peace and the Light of the World. He's the friend of sinners and the enemy of Satan. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He is the way and the truth and the life. Jesus is better. And if you really truly believe it, it's gonna cost you. You're gonna help the poor, defend the powerless, swallow your pride and love your enemies. You're gonna study the scriptures when you'd rather scroll your phone. You're gonna pray when you'd rather sleep. You're gonna serve when you'd rather be served. And you're gonna speak up when you'd rather be silent. But when it's all said and done, you won't regret it. You'll say, it was worth it. Jesus is better. I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ. In other words, Jesus is better. 13 letters, three words, one sentence, and no question about it, Jesus is better.
I don't know if you've figured it out by now, but we're all about Jesus here at Southland. I think back to quite a few years ago, before Stephanie's dad, Joe, passed away, anytime we'd come to the house and be in a conversation, he would, when I would say something, he would always say, "Who told you that? I can't possibly know it myself. Someone had to tell me that." So, I mean, even if I'd say, "It takes 2.5 hours to drive from Greenwood to London, Ohio," he would say, "Who told you that?" I mean, I just did that. I can know that. But here's the thing. I hope every Sunday when you come here and you listen, you ask yourself, who told him that? I want you to ask that question because I got nothing for you but what God said to the world through his word and through Jesus. And so this entire year, 2024, we're going to talk about what he said. We're going to talk about what he told us about himself, about life and death, about family and marriage and relationships and when he's coming again. We're going to spend the whole year on what he said. And I'm really excited about it, to be diving into the Gospels throughout 2024 and really focusing on it. Now that we've done the four G's and we're all dialed into having experienced his grace, and we're growing in our understanding of him, and we're giving of ourselves, and we are going to the world. Now we're going to listen to what he said. And so in February, this first series, it's going to be what Jesus said about himself. And he's got four, he had seven I ams, but I'm going to focus on four of those I ams for you today. And this today is all about him saying, I am. So Jesus said, I am. What does that mean? And so if you'll open your Bibles to John chapter 8, we're going to spend some time unpacking this whole conversation that Jesus had with these guys that weren't too fond of him. Now, the whole Gospel of John is about the deity of Christ. Now, we use that term deity to say he himself is God, God in the flesh, incarnate, born as God himself. And so we believe in here something called the Trinity, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, all making up God himself, one God in three persons. And it's the thing that really separates Christianity from all of the other religions of the world. And it's important to unpack that from time to time. While others pointed out the importance of Jesus' holy nature, and we'll quote some of those others besides the gospel writers who quoted him, did Jesus actually claim deity for himself? Did he himself say it? Well, John chapter 1 tells us, John declares that Jesus is in fact God made flesh. In the name of the Word, Jesus is born to the world, or I love how the Message puts it, Jesus is born and moves into the neighborhood, your neighborhood. And John records many teachings of Jesus as well, including many of his miracles are all in this gospel to show us he is who the world declares him to be, God himself. But here's an important point. We have a huge advantage over the people who were listening to Jesus talk at the time, because we have something called the resurrection. His resurrection from the dead validates him as an authority, not only on himself, but on the world, and that's why we trust him. Now, sure, someone can say anything they want to say about themselves, but the resurrection is what gives Jesus credibility now for all of us on this side of the empty tomb. Now, like most influential people in the world, Jesus had his critics, he had his opponents, he had his enemies, and those who wanted him stopped. And so early in John chapter 8, actually beginning with verse 12, Jesus says he's the light of the world, and the religious leaders who were opposing him said a person's testimony about themselves is not a valid testimony. I could tell you anything about myself, right? And Jesus says, well, you have no idea what you're talking about. That's my paraphrase of what he said. And then he begins to talk to them about who God says he is. They try to tell him they are special because they are descendants of Abraham, and Jesus explained to them that they're doing things that Abraham would have never caused them to do, especially when it comes to harming him. But after telling them they aren't listening to God, this is where the conversation picks up that I want to focus on with you this morning. So at John chapter 8, beginning with verse 48, the people retorted, "You Samaritan devil, didn't we say all along that you were possessed by a demon?" "No," Jesus said, "I have no demon in me, for I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. And though I have no wish to glorify myself, God is going to glorify me. He is the true judge. And I tell you the truth, anyone who obeys my teaching will never die." Now, notice Jesus contrast the actual charges made against him. Samaritan, devil, possessed, demonic. He says, I can't be those things because of these three things. The first one we've read already, that Jesus is glorified by God, but we'll also talk about how Jesus is the fulfillment of God's promise and that he is God himself in the flesh. Now, let's unpack the first one, because this is how he says God is revealing him to the world. Jesus is glorified by God. Now, again, we have a huge advantage over these people who are rejecting Jesus' claim here, because we now have the resurrection and they didn't yet. But earlier in the conversation, Jesus showed the contrast between his father and their fathers. His being God and theirs being the father of lies, deception, murder, pride, and destruction. So when they said, "You Samaritan devil," they tried to make themselves feel better by casting him as someone who was an opponent of the original plan of God. And so they used two points of shame. First, they called him a Samaritan. Now, to us, we're just like, well, what does that mean? Well, Samaritans were people who were Jews, but they were allowing other practices and other religions into their worship of God and their lifestyles. And so they were really shunned by the Jewish people, the pure Jewish people. And then he says, the devil, Samaritan devil. It doesn't get any lower than that. You talk about trash talk. Samaritan devil, the enemy of God and his people. And thus Jesus' emphasis on the word my father versus your father. And then he offers another contrast, where his glory comes from. You see, the power hungry could only try to keep their power by declaring it themselves and then oppressing and lording it over other people, making life hard for other people, established their power. Jesus said, I didn't come here looking for power or glory, but it's God himself who has given it to me from all eternity. And in verse 50, if you were to jump there, he said, and though I have no wish to glorify myself, God is going to glorify me. Now again, we have the advantage of hearing what Jesus said about himself on this side of the resurrection. I'll keep saying that throughout the message today. But some people want to make Jesus out to be either an evil person, like these leaders did, like some kind of lunatic, or merely a great moral teacher from history. But it's interesting what C.S. Lewis said in light of that accusation. C.S. Lewis said, a man who was merely a man and said the sort of things Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on the level of a man who says he's a poached egg, or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. In college, we called this the three L's. He was either a liar, a lunatic, or the Lord. So because he's making bold statements here about how he's being glorified by God and contrasting himself with these guys who he says are children of the devil. By the way, it's interesting how we talk about being so careful about what we say. And you know, we should be timid almost, is what we're told. Jesus is calling these people children of the devil. I mean, he's getting really in their face about the reality of the truth. Now, I'm not asking you to go out and find everybody you can and call them children of the devil. Please don't do that. My point is, we do not have to be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when we know it, we can share it with confidence, doing so with love and respect for the person that we're talking to. It's why it's so important to make this decision, to recognize the importance of the fact that he is not just a crazy man or a good man even from history, but that he is the Lord. In your own personal determinations of what is true, God allows you to decide for yourself who you think Jesus is. That's a beautiful thing, don't you think? That the God of the universe, who has created billions of galaxies and has created this world and given you life upon it, now gives you the opportunity with your own free will to determine whether or not you will believe that Jesus is glorified in his presence. If he's Lord himself, then what he said matters. And to all generations of history, it matters. And men and women, to you, it matters what he had to say. Now, their conversation then continues. Look at verse 52. The people said, "Now we know that you are possessed by a demon. Even Abraham and the prophets died, but you say, anyone who obeys my teaching will never die. Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died, and so did the prophets. Who do you think you are?" Jesus answered, "If I want glory for myself, it doesn't count. But it is my Father who will glorify me. You say he is our God, but you don't even know him. I know him. And if I said otherwise, I would be as great a liar as you. But I do know him and obey him. Your father Abraham rejoiced as he looked forward to my coming. He saw it and was glad." Now, what is he saying here? Well, to me, he makes it clear that Jesus himself is the fulfillment of God's promise. Now, if you were to press rewind, clear back to Genesis chapter 18, verse 18, you would see there God having a conversation with Abraham. And during that conversation, he makes a promise to Abraham that his descendants will become a great and powerful nation, and all nations will be blessed through him and his descendants. Now, indeed, Israel became great, but then ultimately fell away from God because in their blessing, they stopped respecting God, his laws, and his commands. And it led to their suffering and their captivity and their loss of identity. Jesus says he is the one who restores God's people to their rightful place. Now, the interesting thing is when you read that promise, people get it in their mind that it means that Abraham's descendants will ultimately become the largest of all of the religions of the planet. And so you could think that it's all about how big we are. And so, for instance, today, Christianity is the largest in terms of population of a religion on the planet. There are 2.2 billion people who would testify to being part of the Christian faith. That's 31.5% of the population. Now, we can think that means, yeah, we win. We're bigger. And that's not what he meant at all by saying that he would bless you and make your descendants multiply like the sands of the sea. Actually, Jesus said, "Narrow is the way to life, and few are those who find it." So when God made this promise to Abraham that his descendants would be blessed and influential in the world, he wasn't only talking about the family line. He wasn't only talking about their blood race. He was talking about all who would embrace by faith God's will and plan of salvation. And when they did, they would enjoy the fatherhood of God. He would be their heavenly father. And when Israel rebelled and abandoned God, the Lord didn't give up on them. And that's what Jesus was saying, that he tells them, the person that your father Abraham was actually looking forward to my coming to the world. Because he understood that this wasn't just about how many people are on the planet in that line, but people who would believe and trust the words of God, the direction of God, the design of God, the purpose of God, the law and commands of God. See, the law, the sacrifices, and the commands were all pointing toward the redemption of humanity through Jesus Christ. This is what Jesus was talking about when he was confronted by these enemies, these opponents. Jesus didn't pull any punches with these guys. Did you notice that in the reading? I mean, earlier in John chapter 8, he records that Jesus really laid the wood to them. He calls them liars and sinners and ignorant and from the devil and murderers. It's what he said. I'm just showing you that these people thought they were so spiritual simply because of their line, their race, who they came from physically. But they weren't justified simply because they were in the family line of Abraham. Jesus said, "You think Abraham is your father and that makes you right with God, but what's going to make you right with God is me." That's what he tells them. Now, have you ever had that person in your life that's always telling you stories about how great they are and the great things they've done? You know, and they can't help themselves because they want to make sure that you know what they know about all that they've accomplished. And doesn't it cause you to just kind of roll your eyes, only in your heart though, right? And you think to yourself, yeah, I heard all this before. But contrast that to someone who's honored, talked about highly by other people, from other people. And you begin to raise in your mind respect for that individual. You can't help it as people are honoring them for who they are, what they said, or what they have done. And often we have to say that when Jesus says these things about himself, that's why the leaders wanted a second witness. And Jesus said his second witness was God himself. And they were clueless to who this Father was that Jesus alluded to. He said, my Father says, and they're like, who's your Father? That's how far they were from the real plan of God for the world. Now, this is where his miracles and ultimately his resurrection come in. Jesus revealed that he was the true fulfillment of God's promise to Abraham. He then healed and walked on water and fed 5,000 and did other supernatural things, including raising people from the dead. But it didn't matter to his enemies and his opponents. They didn't like someone moving in on their territory of leadership. And their pride would not allow them to believe that he was who he said he was. And so they killed him, which accomplished God's purpose for the world. Now again, you decide. Was Jesus the promise that God gave to Abraham? Well, if you believe that God glorified Jesus from the beginning and he is the fulfillment of God's promise to Abraham, there's only one thing left to conclude. And this is what Jesus tells them. And here's John's account of it, beginning with verse 57. The people said, you aren't even 50 years old. How can you say you've seen Abraham? And Jesus answered, I tell you the truth. Before Abraham was even born, I am. At that point, they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus was hidden from them and left the temple. You see, here's the bottom line. With Jesus' statement, he is saying to them and to the world and to you, he is God. Now, since they were the descendants of the promised of God to Abraham, these religious leaders wanted to contrast Jesus' authority with their authority. And because they equated their authority to the position as being Abraham's people, they didn't know how old Jesus was, and so they gave him a generous age of 50. And they said, even if you're 50 years old, you couldn't have possibly known Abraham because he existed hundreds of years ago. But Jesus, again, doesn't take their bait. He lays it out for them, knowing they're too stubborn to believe. And I want to pause right there in the middle of all of this and say, are you just too stubborn to believe? Because you understand the ramifications of your belief. That to believe that he is God means the words that he said are true and impact your life. Now, John was written in the Greek language, and sometimes it's great and helpful to us to unpack that original language to understand our English translations. And so there are two ways to translate I am. In the Greek, there's ego, which is I am, as in I am present, or I am here, or I am tall. And then there's I me. And I me is the I am of my personhood, my being, who I am. Now, they're often said together. Ego, I me, I am, and then something follows. Like Jesus said, I am the true vine, and he uses ego, I me, and then goes on to say this characteristic of himself. Now, in this case, he ends a sentence with ego, I me, which simply means this. In ending the sentence, he's saying, I am, I am. I am the I am. Now, they would all be familiar with God naming himself to Moses in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. When Moses asked God, when people ask me who sent me to them with this great message, what is your name that I should tell them? And God said to him, tell them, I am, has sent you. And here Jesus says to these religious leaders and his opponents, I am, I am. And he declares to all of them, he is indeed God in the flesh. Notice the present tense. He didn't say, before Abraham was, I was. But before Abraham was, I am. I always have been, I am now, and I always will be. This is what Jesus said about himself. Jesus said, I am God. Now, his declaration of his deity and his oneness with God is what he's trying to communicate here. The deity of Jesus is the foundational truth of our faith, men and women. It is what makes you a follower of Jesus, is to believe in that reality. That's where it all starts for you. To call yourself a Christian, a follower of Christ, it begins with acknowledging that Jesus himself is God in the flesh. And it's important to not only understand this truth and believe it, but also to receive it and ultimately choose to live by what he said. And that's why I wanted to start with what he said about himself and that he is the I am, as we look to the whole year talking about what he said. Because what he said's worth listening to. Why? Because he is I am. He is God who speaks into our hearts and lives. I've been doing this ministry thing 37, 38, I don't know. I lost count. Years. And I've had a lot of conversations with people who call themselves Christians. And it's interesting when you have that conversation, so many different perspectives come out of it, but inevitably, I always want to say, where do you get the understanding that you are indeed a Christ follower? How do you know? Is it simply because you identify as Christian? Because we have to be more than just identifying as Christian. This is truly a transformative experience that takes place in your life when you put your faith in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. It's more than just the religion that you've chosen or that you were born into. It becomes a decision that you make, therefore God doing a work in your heart. And we had a great team that went to Israel this last fall, and we had a wonderful tour guide. And I had this conversation with him where I just asked him, I said, hey, would you mind telling our group your story of how you became a Christian? And he said, I'm not a Christian. I mean, surprise me. I would have surprised everybody on the team. But he said, no, I'm not a Christian. He said, I believe Jesus is the Son of God and I follow him. He was differentiating between the label and the institution of Christianity and what it means to truly follow Jesus. And I love that. Now, you can keep saying you're Christian. It's okay. But I want you to understand what that means in terms of your belief system and who leads your life. His emphasis, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the God I follow. And if you believe Jesus is the Son of God, God incarnate, God in the flesh, you are a true follower of him. You're more than just a churchgoer or a person who self-identifies as Christian. You truly believe he is God, and therefore he must be trusted and he must be obeyed. And when you grasp this reality, you will seek him daily. You will want to know what he said so that you can live your life to glorify him, just as God did when he baptized him and said, "This is my son with whom I am well pleased." The Apostle Paul said it this way. He's writing a letter to his friends in Colossae, and he says it like this: Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones and kingdoms and rulers and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. Followers of Jesus, if you want to memorize one verse of the Bible, that's it. Everything was created through him and for him, including you. It's why we live and breathe. So C.S. Lewis then continues, "But let's not come up with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He didn't intend to. He wants to be your Lord. He wants to be the leader of your life. He is God. And today, the question is before you. Do I believe that? Do I believe him when Jesus says, 'I am, I am'?" Let's bow our heads together. Oh Lord Jesus, in this moment, we can hear your voice calling to all of us, saying to us, you are indeed God the Son, God in the flesh, and that you love us and have forgiven us and are ready to welcome us into your family as our Father. Oh Lord Jesus, help those today who are hearing this to believe. I can't make them believe, Jesus, but your Holy Spirit can. And so I'm asking you to remove the pride and the stubbornness from anyone who wants to refuse you today. And help them to relax and receive the glorious freedom that comes from knowing you. Lord, I give all who are hearing this message today to you right now. Speak to our hearts, we pray. You go ahead and pray your own prayer. And maybe your only prayer today is this: I believe, Jesus, that you are the Son of God. Change my life. Forgive me. And help me live for you. I'm encouraging you to pray that prayer, and today it'll be the most important choice you will ever make. For those of you who are following him, ask him to affirm that truth in your heart today and to give you the strength and the courage to tell this story to others. You take time right now and you respond in prayer to what you heard this morning. Now, Lord Jesus, seal this truth to our hearts. And when the opponent comes with temptation or doubt, we pray that you would remind us again and again. He is risen from the dead. He has proven he is who he said he is. And we thank you for giving us this great hope through our Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. Come on, let's stand and let's celebrate him, and let's continue to respond to his Spirit.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word.
Perhaps today is the first time you've ever heard something like this about Jesus Christ, and it's causing you to wonder and ask questions, and we're here for that. You know, we want to be all about that. And after the service, we'll have some great people down here in front. If you'd like to just come down, talk to us, ask us questions, pray for you, we'd love the opportunity to do that. Most of all, I pray that you would continue to think about this all through the day, all through the month, that the one that you know as Lord of your life is worth trusting with the commands that he gives. It's the best life because Jesus is indeed better. And so for all of you with us online, I hope you'll communicate with us as well. Use the chat and let us know what your questions are. Stick around for just a minute, though. Ben's going to talk a little bit more about how you can respond to what you experienced in worship today. We're so glad you're with us. Look forward to next week. I hope you'll find your way back here in person as well. God bless you, and have a great week.